Today's topic is intestinal obstruction. Intestinal obstruction exists when there is blockage and it prevents the normal flow of intestinal content throughout the intestinal tract. Anywhere in the intestine, either in the portion of small intestine or large intestine, if there is any type of blockage, it will prevent the normal flow of intestinal content to pass through. So this will cause obstruction. The two mechanism, how the obstruction occurs, there are two mechanism. One is mechanical cause or mechanical cause of obstruction. Second one is functional cause of obstruction. So intestinal obstruction can involve only the small intestine or large intestine, or it can occur via systemic alterations involving both the small and large intestine, which is called as generalized ileus. Obstruction can involve a mechanical obstruction, or in contrast may be related to ineffective motility without any physical obstruction, or so called functional obstruction. It is called as paralytic ileus. So in mechanical cause, how the obstruction occurs, it is because of adhesions. Most common cause of adhesion in India, it is abdominal TB, where the intestines, the wall of the intestines, or intraluminally there are formation of adhesion bands. Then Crohn's disease. Next mechanical cause is intussusception, volvulus, then any hernia in the abdomen, then tumor, stricture, atresia. Atresia means not for the intestinal for the portion of intestine is not fully developed. So there is formation of atresia or stricture. Let us see diagrammatically, like in the intestinal lumen, if there is large gallstone, it can cause obstruction. Foreign body obstructions, excess of worm infestation which are lodged in the intestinal lumen can cause obstruction. Feces or fecolith, you can say stone like fecal matters, if they are accumulated, it can cause definitely obstruction. Next, see diagrammatically how the intestinal tumor looks. Intussusception means the bowel is telescoped. That means, for example, you can see in the diagram that how the bowel slips into the large intestine. One part of the intestine slips into another part located below it, like a telescope shortening. So how it can cause obstruction? The intestinal lumen becomes narrow and blood supply becomes strangulated. This is intussusception. Next, volvulus. Volvulus, in this the bowel twists and turns on itself, and so it will occlude the blood supply. Let us see the functional causes of intestinal obstruction. Functional cause means there is no stricture, no hernia, there is no formation of adhesions, there is no tumors, etc. But here what can be seen, that like in peritonitis, there is paralytic ileus. Electrolyte imbalance also causes paralytic ileus. Paralytic ileus means there is paralysis in the intestine, that means peristalsis is stopped. Because of absence of peristaltic movement, intestinal obstruction occurs. Here there is no mechanical cause. Then post-operative cause is either the bowel has been manipulated, so there is no peristaltic movement and the patient experiences intestinal obstruction, or the patient has been given a lot of sedatives, that is also causing reduced peristalsis or no peristalsis in the abdomen. This is causing obstruction, functional obstruction. Then next is ischemia. Ischemia also, that means reduce blood supply to the bowel. This will also reduce the peristaltic movement, and there is functional intestinal obstruction. Drugs like opioids, etc., this is also causing same reduced peristaltic movement. Then any type of muscular weakness, reduced peristaltic movement, again it will cause reduced peristaltic movement. Parkinson's disease, etc. Diabetes, this also cause the nervous system is affected, so here also because of reduced peristaltic movement there can be functional obstruction. Now what happens in obstruction? Above the obstruction, the peristalsis will increase in a that means the reverse peristalsis will increase, intestine will dilate. After that there will be reduction in the peristaltic strength, and flaccidity and paralysis will occur. Below the obstruction, normal peristalsis and absorption until the bowel becomes empty. It contracts and becomes immobile. The intestine is distended because of the accumulation of gas and fluids. Now, how gas is formed in the intestine? It is due to swallowed air. When we are taking food and water, then bacterial overgrowth. This is also causing formation of gas. Then diffusion from the blood also causes formation of gas. Fluids accumulation. Fluids are due to ingested fluid, what we are taking, then saliva, gastric and intestinal juices, bile and pancreatic secretions. The next, in intestinal obstruction there is dehydration. Dehydration is caused due to reduced intake, reduced absorption and increased loss because of vomiting and sequestration. This I will explain afterwards. Let us see the systemic effect of obstruction. Systemic effect means the total, how the whole body gets affected. In that, water and electrolyte losses, toxic material and toxemia occurs. Then cardiopulmonary dysfunction occurs, renal failure because of hypovolemia and hypovolemic shock and death. In case of valvulus, there is bowel strangulation. The strangulation leads to impaired venous return, increased congestion. Increased congestion will cause free peritoneal fluid, edema of the intestinal wall, blood in the lumen, impaired arterial supply, ischemia and gangrene. So, if we see the signs and symptoms, the small intestinal obstruction, the signs and symptoms in small intestinal obstruction is more acute, and initially the patient will experience a crampy pain, colicky pain, wave-like pain. The patient will pass blood and mucus, but no fecal matter, no flatus will be passed. After that, vomiting will occur. Vomiting is projectile. Initially, gastric contents are been expelled out or vomiting occurs. Then intestinal contents are also vomited. That means, so vomiting is bile and then fecal vomiting occurs. Due to large amount of vomiting, there is metabolic alkalosis in acute intestinal obstruction. This is very important type of acid-base imbalance in the body because of massive vomiting. Next, sign of dehydration is there. The patient will have drowsiness, sensation of intense thirst, dry tongue and malaise. And after that, because of loss of fluid loss, patient will have hypovolemic shock. In case of large intestinal obstruction, the symptoms will progress gradually and not sudden. Initially there will be constipation, the shape of the stool will alter, there will be blood in the stool, so the person, due to blood in the stool, person can have anemia. Also the person has reduced appetite, then also the person will have anemia, then weight loss due to poor appetite. Later the patient has crampy lower abdominal pain and fecal vomiting will occur. Because of massive vomiting, there will be symptom of shock. How to do diagnosis? You can easily see the patient's general condition. If we examine by the stethoscope, there will be no bowel sounds. The abdomen will appear very much distended. If we take history, then the patient will say that the vomiting was projectile, fecal content was also there, it was very small, foul smelling. Then the person will show profound sign of dehydration. When we are doing the X-ray, in X-ray there will be gas and fluids. This will be seen on the X-ray. CT scan and MRI can also be done to find out the cause of intestinal obstruction, whether it is mechanical or functional, and the exact area where the obstruction has occurred. But in these intestinal obstruction cases, barium studies are contraindicated. These are not done. Then plasma tests or the blood tests are also done to find out the level of electrolytes, and complete blood count is also done. So the treatment will be, first we have to keep the patient nil per oral. That means we do not have to give anything by mouth. We have to then put a nasogastric tube for decompression of the stomach, and also that can be used for aspiration of gastric contents. Then to maintain the fluids and electrolyte balance, IV fluids can be given, electrolyte therapy can be given, analgesics IV can be given, antibiotics is the cause of obstruction is peritonitis. Then the patient is posted for emergency surgery, because to correct the obstruction, if it is mechanical, then we have to do surgery. Same thing is written here, NPO with judicious fluids, NG tube to suction, analgesia. Sometimes anti-emetic is also given in case of partial obstruction. The surgical management is, we have to remove the mechanical obstruction, so it is called as resection of the bowel, and end-to-end anastomosis. When anastomosis, resection and anastomosis is done, one ileostomy or colostomy is also done until the suture area is healed. Sometimes a portion of intestine is removed and ileostomy or colostomy is permanent.